words of power because we are kings and our words matter.
They were against the rich. They were against this whole system that worked like this, that emptied them, that left them poor. So they're in rage and anger inside and resentment, and they go and try to fight this system. They were very happy when Jesus came because they heard him say, the kingdom of God is here.
You are my hiding place. You always fill my heart with song of deliverance whenever I am afraid. I will trust in you. I will trust.
Dominion, dignity, and delight. Three things that God gave to man at the time of creating man, gave it to him as his birthright. Every human being is entitled to live exercising dominion, dignity, and delight. Dominion, dignity, and delight must be enjoyed by man. That is why material prosperity is important. Without material prosperity, it is impossible to enjoy dominion on this earth. Just think for a moment. If you don't have enough money, material, to meet your material needs in this earth, not enough money to pay your rent, buy your food, clothe yourself decently, and educate your children in a decent place, and live decently, if you can't do all that, I'm sure you won't be able to manage any problems that arise. Suppose a person is sick in the home, you can't even take the person to a hospital. You got to think about money. Money is an issue. You know, as soon as you go to the hospital, they say, pay 25,000 rupees and come show the receipt, we'll admit him, you know. Everywhere it's money, money, money. You can't solve any problem. The Bible says money answers all things, you know. I don't know if it'll answer everything, but I'm sure it answers a lot of things in my experience. I found out that it answers a lot of things, maybe not everything. Money cannot buy me my salvation, but it does answer a lot of other things. You got to admit that, you know. It is very useful. And without having enough of material prosperity, you cannot rule over your circumstances. The chaos, emptiness, and darkness of your life, you cannot rule over it. You want to exercise dominion. See, dominion is God-given right. God made everything and said, let them have dominion. Genesis 1, 26 and 28. Let them have dominion. Very big statement, a policy statement. God says, hereafter, this is it. He will rule and reign. Everything I've created, given into his hands, let them have dominion. Let him rule over chaos, emptiness and darkness. Let him manage everything. Let him change everything. Let him set aright everything. Have dominion. Now, dominion is a God-given task for every man. You and I are supposed to have dominion over our emptiness, darkness, and chaos of our life. You cannot have dominion without proper material prosperity. That's why prosperity is very important. You cannot have dignity also without material prosperity. Just think about it once again. If you don't have enough money to buy good food, to have good, decent clothes, to have a decent place to live. I talked about having a decent place to live last week, the last time I spoke about it. You know, some people are of the idea, well, you know, it doesn't matter, I can live in a dump. Well, you can live in a dump, but you are not supposed to live in a dump. Do you know that? You are not made to live in a dump. You are God's child, my friend. God made you in his image and likeness. Don't insult God, don't insult yourself. You're made to live with a certain level of dignity. Nobody can deny that. I'm made to live like that. You and I were made for dignity, to live in dignity. We are made in the image and likeness of God. When God made man, Genesis 1:26, he said, let's make man in our image and likeness. When he said that, he has already endowed man with dignity. By making man in his image and likeness, he has given man a dignity that is unmatched in all creation. No other creation has that kind of a dignity. Man is given dignity like you could never imagine. It must be preached in Christian church. We ought to live in dignity. We ought to live in a decent place. We ought to eat good, healthy food. We ought to be able to have good clothes. We ought to be able to educate our children in a good place. We ought to be able to provide for our family on a decent level. Dignity. Try not having any money. Try not having any material prosperity. First of the month comes, you lose all your dignity when the house owner comes and asks you for the rent. You know. All your dignity will be flying up in the air. You know. No dignity. You got to have some material prosperity in order to live in dignity. You can't buy decent clothes. You can't live in dignity. You cannot have rags to clothe yourself with and live in dignity. You got to dress yourself decently in order to live in dignity. I hope you agree with that, you know. I don't know why people oppose me for teaching this. They got to be crazy. What am I teaching? This is not just a money issue. This is a dignity issue. This is a dominion issue. And dominion and dignity is my birthright. When God created man, every man was made for dominion and dignity. That's why prosperity is important. The third thing is delight. The enjoyment of life. To be happy. It's my birthright to be happy, my friend. To enjoy everything that God has made and to live in it and to thrive in it. That's why God put man in the Garden of Eden. He said, eat of all the fruit of all the trees. Only one tree was forbidden. Everything you can eat. Don't even hesitate. Don't even have second thoughts about it. Enjoy everything. Freely eat. I love that. Freely eat. Just enjoy yourself, he says. Why? Because God wants man to live and enjoy everything that he has made. Just like you would love to see your son or daughter enjoy all the good things that you have earned and kept for them. God is a much better God than any one of us here. We're all good parents in our own way, but he is 1,000 times better. He loves to see his children live in the enjoyment of the things that he has made for them. And that enjoyment is not possible without prosperity. I hope you understand now. It's not just a money issue. It's a dominion issue, it's a dignity issue, and it is a delight issue. These three things are not possible without material prosperity. All right. Now that's the essence of the Old Testament teaching. That's why we went through the Old Testament, basically all of Old Testament, I would say. I said that I went to Amos the last time I preached and I showed you how there is a condemnation of the rich of that day. Not because they were rich, because they were wayward people. They were disobedient people. They were worldly people. They were wicked people. God, the prophet speaks about the bed they sleep in and the couches they lounge in and so on. And tells them that how one day they'll lose all of these things and go back into slavery and so on. He's not condemning them because they were rich. He was not, taking this verse they have preached about how you should not sleep in a cot. I'm not joking, in this very town. Right now what's going on? Just go to YouTube and you'll find how you should not sleep in a cot. You must sleep in a straw mat. There are people who will say, I sleep every day in a straw mat only. One man said, I let my children sleep in the straw mat so that they will not be proud. Oh my God. How can that person be a father? I don't know. You must ask the children, interview the children. See what they think of him, And what kind of idea they'll develop about God, They think they're super spiritual. They're not. These verses should not be used for that. God is not condemning your bed, your expensive bed that you bought, or the mattress. Now, how much mattress cost, you know that? Nowadays? Mattresses, my God, I never thought when I was growing up there are mattresses that cost so much. If you want to sleep comfortably, you want to back your spine to be in good order and keep it in good shape and not bend it out of shape, you got to spend a lot of money to buy one of those beds, And there are those who will criticize you for that. Oh, how can you sleep in a bed like that? Well, you can because it's good for your spine. It's good for you. You can have a good nap. God is not condemning the bed. God is not condemning your sofa set that you bought. God is not you think God is some kind of a silly person that looks at your house and looks at your bed and says, oh my goodness, where did you get that? I'm going to send you right to hell, because you bought that. No. God is the maker of heaven and earth. He lives in absolute splendor and affluence like you don't even have the capacity to imagine that. He lives like that. And you think he's going to be jealous of you sleeping in a nice bed and criticize you for... People have taken these verses and used it to condemn those who enjoy good things in life. That is not a condemnation of enjoyment of prosperity and good things in life. It is a condemnation of their attitude towards God and the things of God and their neglect of their relationship with God. Condemnation of their wickedness in which they live, the injustice they practice, the unrighteousness that is part of their life. Not a condemnation of the prosperity, because God only brought them into prosperity, out of slavery, into the land flowing with milk and honey, a good and a vast land. How would he condemn that? So we went through the Old Testament fully, basically. I told you Amos is one example. That's good enough for the entire Old Testament. All condemnation scriptures come under that category. If you know how to interpret Amos, you know how to interpret the rest of the scriptures. So the Bible is not against material prosperity. It is for material prosperity. The whole point is to take you back to that condition that God first created man and put man in. Now we're going to get into the New Testament. That's why I asked you to read Mark chapter 6. I've not told you which verse. Today, we want to get into the New Testament. And then when you come into the New Testament, there is an obstacle that you have to cross. Because they say, brother, what you have said so far about the Old Testament, I agree. Some people have to agree. Because I've told them from Genesis 1 all the way up, they cannot disagree. They say, all right, I agree. That's God's pattern. Prosperity is God's pattern. Dominion, dignity, and delight. I agree with that. I agree that prosperity is necessary for that. That's God's thing, that he is teaching in the Old Testament. But in the New Testament, the pattern, the paradigm changes, they say. Do you know in the New Testament, the paradigm is poverty? The paradigm is that you live poor. Why? Because they will immediately go to the incarnation, coming of Jesus in flesh. It says the Son of God came and entered this world and identified himself with poverty. he became poor. Not only did he become poor, all his disciples were poor, his followers were poor, and his ultimate teaching was that it is better for all of us to be poor. Now, this is the danger with this. They make Jesus poor, then the apostles poor, Peter, Paul, James, John, everybody poor. And then they say, we also must be poor. If they were rich, I mean, if they were poor, then what right do you have to be rich? You all have to be poor. And they bring it down to how that is a pattern that God has set by his very life, coming down onto this earth, living in poverty. He has set as a pattern, a paradigm for us to follow, a new paradigm, they say. I say the Bible is only one. There's not one Old Testament and New Testament. It's only one. Bible is one. It's only for convenience sake it is separated into Old and the New Testament, you know. It's one. From the beginning to the end, one. There is one Savior. There is one truth. It's all one, you see. So you cannot say that it was right for Old Testament. It's not right for New Testament. So I want to deal with you today, deal with who Jesus is and how. If Jesus was poor, like some people say. Was Jesus poor? Was he born in poverty? Did he live in poverty? Let's consider this question very reasonably today. I think you're all educated, reasonable people, very smart. And I will reason with you today. The Bible is something that you reason with, right? The question is, was Jesus poor? Did he live in poverty? In incarnation, did he identify with poor and poverty and thereby extol the virtues of poverty? Did he magnify, glorify poverty by becoming poor, like some people teach? But the major question is this, I would say. How did the people of his time view him? When they saw Jesus, did they see him as a poor person? Was he poor in their sight? Did they call him a poor man? Did they say, oh, here comes the poor guy that has not even a place to lay his head? He sleeps in the platform over there in that street. He has nothing. He lives with rags. You know, did they identify him like that? Did they see Jesus in that way? Did they see him as poor? Forget about what people see him as today, because people have influenced our people today. They have preached for so long saying that he's poor, so people see him as poor. So let's forget about that. Let's see how they saw him then. What his people saw him, what his people of his day saw him as. Did they see him as poor? Let me read to you Mark's Gospel, chapter 6, verse 3. People talking now. He's preaching in the synagogue, teaching in the synagogue and doing some mighty works in the town where he grew up in Nazareth. And this is the response of the people. Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? So they were offended at him. Their thing is, this guy preaches so wonderfully. Where did he get that? He's in another profession, isn't he? He's a carpenter. How did he end up preaching like this? And he's doing some miracles, like a prophet. How come he became like that? He's a professional carpenter. How is he like this? That's the question they're asking. So the question is, was Jesus poor? How did the people view him? Did they view him as poor? To the answer, you need to first go back and look at the society back then, the Palestine as it was back then. And what they considered poor, what they considered rich, and what they considered middle class, and so on. What was their situation like? Jesus was born in a time where there was a political unrest, basically. The people of Israel lived under the Roman Empire. They hated it, but somehow they had to submit themselves to the rule of the great Roman Empire. They were like a volcano ready to erupt any time. There was a resentment and a hatred towards the Roman rule over them. And riots broke out here and there without any warning. So the Romans always stationed little army units here and there to help the king of the Jews, the Herod there, control everything and keep law and order. Herod, as a king of the Jews, submitted himself to the Romans and ruled with the help of the Romans over the Jewish people, his own people. And so this was the society in general. But let's talk about economics. The poor of that society in Jesus' day. Who were the poor? There were many different kinds of poor in the days of Jesus. The first kind was the people that were in abject poverty, literally living in abject poverty. They were usually the homeless beggars. Usually these people had some kind of a physical handicap. Maybe they're blind, they couldn't walk, they couldn't do some tasks, you know. They're physically handicapped, so they couldn't get into a profession, they couldn't make any money, they couldn't do anything, you know, they couldn't do any work, so they were completely left to beg on the streets. So there will be, we read about stories about how beggars sitting in the street and crying out to Jesus and so on in the New Testament. This was a common thing in those days. There were beggars. And I'm sure in our country we understand very well because we've seen ourselves beggars on the street. But sometimes I wonder whether they are true beggars or not, you know. Some of them are. But we have seen true beggars also. People in abject poverty, really suffering and really begging and so on. Now, this, in some societies, they cannot understand. In some countries, you can be preaching this, what beggar, you know? They've never seen a beggar, you know. But we know, we can understand it better. There were beggars, mostly physically handicapped and sick and wretched in every way. Then there were street children, orphaned and abandoned by parents, living without any family, without a roof over their head, just sleeping here and there, running around here and there, getting something from somebody. You know, basically beggars, you know, if somebody offered something, they will eat and so on. That kind of people. The poorest of the poor. These were the poorest of the poor, and they were oppressed constantly by others and looked down upon others naturally. Then the second kind of poor was the poor that worked, but yet were poor. There were two kinds of such people, working poor. That is, they were day laborers. They worked for daily wages. And then there were slaves. Roman Empire was filled with slaves. Everywhere there were slaves. In all the nations of the world, there were slaves at that time. Slavery and slave market was a common thing. You could go buy yourself a few slaves if you wanted in those days. So the Roman Empire was filled with the slaves. And most of them worked as domestic servants. Did whatever you wanted. They had no right to property. They had no right to anything. They had no right to even wages, you know. Whatever you give them, that's what it is. That's the way they lived. They lived in utmost poverty. But then there are day laborers. You remember in the story, in the parable where Jesus talks about a man who went to the market to get some workers and found some workers and hired them. In the 11th hour, he goes and hires some more and so on, that story. That's a typical picture of those days. You can go to the marketplace where you can get laborers. You want 10, 15 workers for your house or for your garden or your farm. You can go and hire them on a daily basis. But these day laborers were paid on daily contract. And the problem is that they were poor because they only made enough money for that day. If they worked that day, they could fill their stomach that day with food. With what they earned. Only minimum earning, only enough for that day. It won't last until tomorrow. They have to work every day to make their wages. They were very poor. Basically just got by. Just enough to make it through the day. That's all they had. This is the way they lived. And they depended upon daily work contracts. They had no real estate. They had no inheritance. Nothing to lean back on. If they didn't work, they become beggars. That's why. That's the way they were. Then there was another kind of poor. These were small farmers. They are the most unfortunate people. They seem to have a little bit of land, but yet the big ones, the big farmers around them, swallowed them up literally. They dictated the terms. They fixed the prices. They did everything to their advantage, similar to what happens in many places even today. They did everything and took advantage of these farmers. And when they didn't have money, they lent them money and so on. And finally, these fellows will not be able to pay back the money, end up giving the whole farm to them, the small farm that they had, to the big landowners. Losing their lands, they again became landless, poor, and powerless poor. Now some of them, they say, turned into zealots. You read about zealots in the Bible. These are a group of people who turned into revolutionary fighters, you know. They were against the rich. They were against this whole system that worked like this, that emptied them, that left them poor. So they're in rage and anger inside and resentment, and they go and try to fight this system. They were very happy when Jesus came because they heard him say, "The kingdom of God is here."
This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year. Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing and shout and praise the Lord. This is the season of Jubilee.
This is the season of Jubilee.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Singing and dancing for you and me.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Thanking and praising because we're free.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Oh, this is the year of Jubilee.
Put your hands together. Everybody praise the Lord. Put your hands together. Sing and shout and praise the Lord. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. Sing that again. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. Shall be returned unto me. Mother, father, sister, brother, they will all go free. Everything that was stolen shall be returned unto me. Singing, dancing, praising, shouting, increase in victory. This is the season of Jubilee.